to the love of my life, my wife, Jasmine Setty. Though I'm a writer, she's the one who completed my love story. It was the month of July 2015. Everyone was hooked to the popular show Game of Thrones. Those who weren't watching it were relegated as aliens. The Indian web series TVF Pictures, created by the viral fever, was bringing unusual, innovative content to the small screen. But there was still a section of the population that preferred back-to-back episodes of CID and Savdhan India on television on a lazy Sunday morning. Prime Minister Modi had launched the Digital India program to simplify our problems and make the country digitally empowered. But our lives still revolved around the controversial blue ticks on WhatsApp and whether our friend or foe had read our messages or not. However, the problems of the real world trumped those of digital world by a mile. Real-life problems, like introducing your girlfriend to your parents, still scared the shit out of boys. "No, I don't want to be a part of this plan," she exclaimed. "Trust me, it'll work. We can pull it off," I pleaded. I knew that we were technically trying to commit suicide by planning to land up at my house without prior intimation and introducing her as my girlfriend to my parents. Would you deem it any less than a suicide attempt? We were at Starbucks with our friend Deepika and her younger sister Roma when I decided to call my parents. I didn't want to give them too many details, but thought it best to let them know we were coming. I went outside the restaurant to make the call so that I could talk to them without being disturbed. The call took more than a minute, and when I came inside, I could see the anxiety on my girlfriend's face. As she flashed me a worried smile, I decided to calm her down by holding her hand. "They've asked us to come home in an hour," I muttered.
"But what did you say to them?"
she asked with a raised eyebrow.
"I said that I wanted to introduce them to a very special person in my life." "Are you insane? Who on earth does something like this? Fuck, you screwed everything up."
"I didn't, believe me,"
I reassured her. I tried to console her, unsure about the outcome of the meeting myself. My head was filled with ifs and buts. At that moment, I thought about how much impact she had had on my life. I wasn't even fully aware of the effect she had on me. After 3 years of being in a long-distance relationship, we had finally decided to take things to the next level, only to realize that it wasn't as easy as it had seemed. Eventually, I was overwhelmed with more questions than answers. I thought to myself, is there a difference between just spending all your time together and being married? Yes, there is, I realized. Once you tie the knot, the whole dynamic of the relationship changes. The degree of love and affection that you share intensifies immensely. Looking at her, I thought, what did I do to deserve her? Gosh, I'm a lucky man. We never bothered with what others thought about us because only we could understand how much we meant to each other. Having a partner who understands you without you having to say anything is the best feeling in the world. This was one of the most critical days of our lives, as it would decide what lay ahead for us. It was more critical for her as a girl, since her life would go through a complete transformation if everything went according to plan. Girls who pretend it's not such a big deal are the ones who are most affected by it. Putting up a strong front is a defense mechanism for them. She too stayed calm in front of us and didn't let on about the turbulence within her. The four of us drove to my house. Before ringing the doorbell, I hugged her and kissed her forehead to assure her that no matter what the outcome, we would face it together. My mom opened the door and welcomed us in. I tried to read her face to understand what was going on in her head, but I drew a blank. She led us to the drawing room where Dad was sitting, reading the paper.
After casual introductions, we sat on the plush sofa. I could gauge the nervousness on her face. She deliberately did not sit next to me, instead choosing a spot at the far end of the sofa, next to Deepika. Although we had come well prepared, all our preparation vanished into thin air. We sat for a while in silence, waiting for someone else to break the ice.
"Are you already married or what?" Dad questioned.
"Dad?"
I had an annoyed look on my face.
"When you called to tell us about your special someone, we thought you were coming home directly after a court marriage. So, how did you two meet? What's your story?"
Holy shit. His response was totally unexpected. We were not at all prepared for this. At that moment, I felt like a student who had prepared all the chapters for his viva except one, only to find the professor asking questions from that very chapter.
She kept quiet and looked at me nervously.
My father soon slipped from English into his mother tongue, Marathi. Being Punjabi, she could barely understand our conversation, and that made her feel even worse, as she didn't know how to respond or what was expected of her.
Everything seemed alien to her, the place, the language, the people. I looked at her to reassure her that I had everything under control. I took a deep breath and narrated our story.
We met at a bookstore for the first time. Her friend's father owned the bookstore. I got her address through a register the bookstore maintained of all its visitors and sent her a love letter via post, not in the least expecting a reply. But she did reply. Gradually, in the process of exchanging letters, our feelings for each other grew. Soon, we met for the first time, and after a couple of such meetings, we realized we were in love. As I narrated the story, I could sense from everyone's reaction that they didn't believe us at all. I knew I had made a blunder and realized what a pathetic storyteller I was. I wished I could just unsay what had just been said. But that was not an option either. All I could do was nervously wait for my parents to respond.
"Are you sure it's a true story and not make-believe fiction like your books?"
"It's the only story I've ever told truthfully," I concluded, feigning a smile.
A few hours later, romance prevails only when two people manage to convey that they care for each other through small acts of love and affection. It blooms under the constant affection of the significant other, the one who goes out of their way for the sake of your comfort.
I felt the same way when I introduced Jas to my parents, and the smile of contentment on her face told me of her joy.
Jas was short for Jasmine, a name I had lovingly given her soon after we became a couple. At first, my parents were convinced that our story was anything but true. But feelings for Jas, however, persuaded them otherwise. Their affirmative nod to our relationship without any added interrogation on the topic of intercaste marriages was rather unexpected. Because even though we say we live in the 21st century, where religions, customs and traditions are constantly being updated in order to meet the modern lifestyle, when it comes to marriage, we all know that the situation somehow reverses in the blink of an eye. Whatever the reason, it surely called for a celebration. Both of us were in good spirits as we headed to Tap Resto Bar in Bandra, along with our dear friends Deepika and Roma.
"Your dad is so cool, and here I was expecting a full-on Hindi melodrama with your dad donning the scary avatar of Amrish Puri from DDLJ. I'm so glad he turned out to be Anupam Kher instead," Deepika joked as I drove past the Bandra Kurla complex.
"You are such an idiot. At least you should have narrated our story properly," Jas added. I was clueless. If I had to think about it for even a fraction of a second more than I did, it would have sounded completely fake. "But it did sound fake," Jas giggled nervously.
"Whatever, you guys. According to me, this first innings in Mumbai went well. Jas will now have to lead the second innings with her parents in Delhi, so let's see how well she performs," I winked. Jas didn't react and looked out the car window instead. She very well understood that this game was nowhere near over. She was always about orthodox traditions, but I could see in her eyes how worried she was about her parents. With one hand on the steering wheel, I placed the other on her leg. If you can't feel the silence of your partner, you will never understand their words. She placed her hand on mine and looked at me lovingly. The moment was so intimate and sacred that I wished I could capture and frame it for eternity. In the rearview mirror, I could see a confused expression on Roma's face. When we asked what was wrong, she said she was still curious about how we met. She knew we hadn't told my parents the whole truth. We reached the bar and took a table on the rooftop, from where we had a good view of the city and immediately placed an order for snacks and drinks to celebrate. "So when are you getting married?" I asked Deepika. "Why does everyone who gets engaged ask the same question? I mean, if you're going to ruin your life, it doesn't mean that the world will follow you to your grave." "Rest in peace, Aditya. I will sincerely mourn your death," Deepika teased. "I won't let him die so soon. I still have to make optimum use of his credit cards. Until then," Jazz trailed off, slyly. I ignored them and directed my next question at Roma, who still looked like her mind was elsewhere. "Why are you so quiet?" "Because I have some questions for both of you. Shall I?"
"Sure, go ahead," Jazz answered.
"Was it really true, all that you told your dad? I want the complete story if you don't mind relieving it for me," said Roma. "The one Aditya narrated to his parents?" Jazz responded, barely being able to conceal her laughter.
"Please tell me the truth. It's killing me. How can it be possible? Letters through post, and that too in the age of social media apps? Are you guys retarded or taking up monkhood?"
Roma kept bombarding us with questions one after another. We had told Deepika to keep the finer details of our relationship a secret, and it seems like she had stayed true to her word, not even disclosing the facts to her sister. No one spoke for several seconds.
"So, was all of that true?"
she badgered.
"Not at all. The real story is something else," I grinned, taking Jazz's hand in mine.
I shifted my gaze to Jazz, who had probably in a split second recollected all the moments that we had lived through. Every relationship requires effort, but a long-distance relationship requires extra effort. One of the greatest surviving myths about long-distance relationships is that they are more likely to fail than any other kind of relationship. However, Jazz and I are a living testament to long-distance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.